The one in Indy, the one where the Colts play the Texans, the one where Andrew Luck tied the game with less than a minute to go. Fast forward to overtime, 4th and 4 from their own 43, less than 30 seconds left. Indy doesn't convert. Frank Reich opts to go for it. The decision did not pay off. Texans kick the game-winning field goal 3 plays later for their first win of the season. Went through that pretty fast, but Colts head coach Frank Reich explained his decision after the game.
We're not playing to tie. I mean, we're going for that 10 times out of 10. I mean, that's just the way it's got to roll.
We discussed earlier, Coach, whether we're analyzing these games in hindsight or moving forward, but what did you make of his decision there?
I didn't like the decision at the time, and I understand the idea of being aggressive and not playing for a tie. But when you've gone that far into the game and you put your team in a position to at least come out of it with a tie and you make that decision where they made it, you know that if you don't get it, odds are that the other team is going to be able to convert and the other team's going to win the game. And the play call itself seemed pretty uninspired. They came out initially, there was a timeout, and then they run hitches at the sticks against press coverage. It didn't feel like that was a decision that he said was his
only regret, that he called a timeout, that they should have just moved forward with it as if.
Yeah, I thought the initial formation, at least you had some potential against man-to-man defense to get some type of rub routes. That what they came out with the second time was a very standard sticks-type play against press man-to-man coverage. Didn't seem high percentage, and the whole situation felt more reactionary than the thought process of no matter what happens here, we're going to go for this. And saying we're not going to play for a tie, would they have done the same thing if it was 4th and 6? What if it was 4th and 8? What if it was 4th and 10? Were they going for it on 4th down no matter what? And did he tell the play caller on 3rd down, hey, whatever happens here, this is 4 down territory? Because that affects things as well. And the quarterback, he needs to know, I've got 2 downs here as opposed to 1 down. And none of that felt like it was happening as it unfolded.
I don't think that it was the right call to go for it. But there were way worse coaching calls all throughout the day in the NFL. Calls that are no-brainers. Calls like to call a timeout at the end of the half. The Giants and Steelers blew that. The Texans in this game themselves, in before overtime and during overtime, calls that aren't a questionable decision. And the way this was covered during the game, as if Frank Reich it was coaching malpractice, I think is totally unfair. I understand why he would do it. He's feeling, if I punt the ball here, we have 0% chance to win. If I go for it, now they still have about another 15 yards to gain. They didn't have timeouts. That's why I didn't love the decision, was even if they pick it up, you still might end up with a tie. But the other side of it is, if we don't get it, the Texans are going to have to execute. They're going to have to get at least 10 yards in about 20 seconds in order for them to have a field goal, because they were not in Kaim Fairbairn's field goal range from that moment. So I understand why he did it. I don't think it was the right call, but I don't think it was an egregious call the way I felt it was discussed during the game and the commentary after the game. It was treated as if it was a no-brainer that he made the wrong decision. And if he's looking at the division and saying, man, a tie is as good as a loss if we're trying to win this division, if we're trying to catch Jacksonville or catch Tennessee. Like that half game is not going to help us. It's having a half game more in a loss column is not going to hurt us as much as having a half game more in the win column would help us.
Coach Mangini, I know this is going to shock you. I totally agree with you. And the reason why, because I didn't think the team knew. And Brian Billick used to always tell me something. Chris, if you want to be able to suggest plays to me in critical situations, I need you to think like me. I need you to memorize all of our critical throws, all of our 3rd down, all of our red zone. And when you can do that, then I'll let you have more input. I know you have a great football mind and I respect it and everything, but if you want to have better communications on Sunday, I didn't think that the 3rd down call was synced up with we're going for it on 4th down. And I don't have my #1 wide receiver. I'm going to tell you what they ran. Now, they ran rocket right or double right, all stops. All right? When you have a 4th or 3rd in 4 to 6, it's all stop. It's a customary route around the NFL. Everyone runs it. All right? Critical situation. But you don't have no wide receiver that's going to be able to get in and out of of that collision because he's only right 2 yards beyond the chuck zone. So you know they're going to play man. No one is going to play zone on fourth down. No, they're going to play man-to-man. So the stop route against man-to-man, it is not unless you have a number one guy or a big physical guy or a big tight end. They didn't have those. T.Y. Hilton is on the bench with a bad hamstring. So that's the reason. Not because you don't like it. Not because they didn't get it. Number one, it wasn't synced up with the team. And that defense, it's irresponsible to them to make them have to go out there and make one more stop. All right, you didn't get the first down on three, punt it down, all right, because the defense gets a tie. And when you go back into the office and you didn't lose in that half a game, it's a big difference the next week. So, Frank Wright, I believe it was a bad call, all right, because sometimes a tie is necessary. And in that game yesterday, a tie was necessary if they didn't pick it up.
Yeah, and a couple things here. We don't know what a tie is going to mean to this division at this point. We've got a long way to go, and I've heard the comparison between, okay, he was in Philadelphia and they were aggressive in the Philly special. That wasn't the Philly special. That was literally a play that says, my guy is better than your guy, and that matchup, that wasn't the case.
And Philadelphia is going to be able to bring that rush. Their defense was playing better. So a lot of time when you make an aggressive call, it's because Bill Belichick, I'm afraid of Peyton Manning, or I got a great freaking defense.
Yeah, it's one of those things. And to evaluate the call in the context of other mistakes that other people made, I don't think that's the way to look at a call either. I don't think we say, well, other people made mistakes the other day. And look, if he felt good about that call, if that was a gotta-have-it play that they practice, if Andrew Luck knew what they were going to do, if they liked the matchup, if they were doing all those things, then I say, okay, go ahead and take that chance. I totally get it, and I'm never going to criticize someone for doing that because that's their thought process,
yes,
and they believed in it. But it didn't feel like they had gone into that situation saying, this is what we're going to do if we get to fourth down. And in critical moments, you need to be definitive and strong, and the guys need to know what they're doing.
I wholeheartedly agree with that. And if we want to pick apart justifiably, I think it's critical to know if you're going to go for it on fourth, that affects your third down call. That's what you're talking about, being synced up with the play calling. If we want to talk about their third down play call, the actual play they ran on fourth down, if they were doing the mental math of, even if we pick this up, how likely is it we get in field goal range? All of those things are totally fair critiques that I think are legitimate. It's why I said I don't think I would have gone for it. But the idea that in that setting, that fourth and four with 27 seconds left on your own 43-yard line in a tied overtime situation, that it's a must punt, that I reject flatly. Now, because T.Y. Hilton's out, because of other extenuating circumstances, what they ran on third down, I understand why there's criticism. But there is a logical case to be made in that spot that you go for it because even if you don't get it, you still, all you have to do is make one stop defensively and the game, and it's a tie either way. So now you can say they don't have the defensive personnel. There's a lot of reasons to criticize it. And the reason I brought up the other situations was we're not going to lead a segment talking about some other coaching decisions that were not questionable. They were no-brainers, and the Jets punted down 12 with 4 minutes left in the game. Like, that's a no-brainer. You can't do that, and they did it. So there were a lot. Frank Reich's getting killed today and will be killed today, and I don't know if that part of it's fair.
And also, it's important to note that a lot of the players that were interviewed afterwards said, we love the fact that he had such faith in the offense and he was being aggressive, and we love that.
They have to do that.
Okay.
They have to do that. You can't throw the coach. Even if the coach makes the wrong decision, you all have to be in sync. That's a good organization. That means they're buttoned up in comments. Even the stuff that you're not happy with, you're still going to say, I'm gonna help my guys. This is also Frank Wright. It's his first job.
Right.
So the players did a good job of that after the game.
I got to ask you about Andrew Luck real quick. Where are we now 4 games in with Luck after what you saw yesterday? Is he on the same trajectory we thought he'd be on when this season started?
Well, we didn't really know what trajectory he would be on. He's obviously playing at a much better level each week, and we're going to have to give him some time, not only with the injury, but also with the fact that this is a new offense, and that's going to take a while for him to get in total sync with what they're trying to achieve, how they're trying to achieve it. His numbers are a little bit down from the previous year, and But it's trending upward. It's definitely trending upward. And I'm a big Andrew Luck fan, so I might be a little bit biased here. But I do see more and more positive things.
Yeah, he can quarterback my team.
He can quarterback my team, too. And then the main thing is the injury doesn't seem to be on his mind anymore. And that's what I was looking for in the early part. How much is he really factoring that in? And it doesn't seem to be a factor at all.
When Andrew Luck was last playing with the Colts, they were a different offense. T.Y. Hilton, Moncrief, Gore, Philip Dorsett, and a tight end. Now, they don't have a whole bunch of talent. So when you start evaluating Andrew Luck, evaluate 400 yards, 440 completions to 9 different receivers.
Yep.
All right? Dude can play for me.
Week 3 was, we talked about it, a step backwards in his road to recovery, I thought. Yesterday was an enormous or a couple steps forward. He had 450 yards, 4 touchdowns, and no picks. And his team lost. That's the only second time that's happened since the merger. Like, he played well enough to win. They had no running game. There were 17 of 41 on the ground. They lost T.Y. Hilton, as you mentioned. Luck played. There are a lot of reasons the Colts lost that game. Andrew Luck's nowhere near on that list. He looked excellent. And, I mean, they had him throw the ball 62 times. Like, big ask, and he was great, I thought.
All right, Coach, stick around. Coming up on the other side is the key to success for the Cowboys. Less Dak and more Zeke. That's next on First Things First.